Hey PC fans, Gordon Ung with PC World here. We are still at Corsair's Gaming HQ Center with Kevin Galloway, technical marketing, electrical engineer too. We are gonna pick his brains because this memory stuff, it's really hard to remember. Ba-dum-bum. I have to say that because I've forgotten all kinds of memory stuff and I need his help. First question I wanna note though, because we have here in front of us, the Dominator Platinum RGBs. The big deal, of course, is these have the Capellix LEDs on top. But I do want to know, because everybody has to have the RGB RAM. I love it. The stuff looks awesome. Do you give up anything to run RGB?
I mean, does it hurt the performance at all?
No. I mean, if you were to put like 100 something LEDs, maybe then it would start dip into that power supply. But there's enough overhead there that it won't affect the performance. So.
Okay.
Yeah, especially not with the Capellix LEDs. We're really pushing these because they're better on power consumption, brighter, and you can fit a lot more, which I guess is kind of a double-edged sword. So.
Now, you can get 100 LEDs in there. So.
Potentially, yeah.
These are, we're rated for what?
These are 3,000 megahertz.
Oh, so yeah. 3,000 megahertz?
Yes.
Can you say what the dyes are? Because there's very much people that are into RAM, they want to know, are they Samsung B dyes? There's the new Samsung A dyes. Mm-hmm. What's the feeling on that?
Generally speaking, for like 3000 and above, we typically go with Samsung B dye, but that doesn't mean we don't use like Hynix and other ones also. And for us, Hynix it performs just about as equally as the B dye. I think the B dye is just really evangelized on the internet because of the overclocking scene and stuff, but that's not to say they aren't really good. It's just, I think maybe people don't give enough credit to the Hynix chips, but yeah.
But I guess you should care if you are an overclocking sports.
Yeah, of course.
Sports.
Yeah.
Mostly. If I'm building a build with just, and I'm gonna run 3000, does it really matter that much?
Not particularly, no. I mean, if you're looking to set like some world record or something and you're cooling it with like liquid nitrogen or something, then maybe, you know.
But unless you're, other than that, for most people, it's not going to matter too
exactly.
much.
Yeah.
And speaking of the A dyes, I guess those are the new 10 nanometer chips.
Yes.
The A dyes. Yeah. What do you think that's going to change as far as PC memory goes?
So there's speculation that it's going to create higher cost efficiency, I guess. So it'll basically bring the price of memory down. There's some concern that with the lower clocks, I guess, that it will have some performance issues. Not issues necessarily, but the performance will be impacted. But year over year, you can see that we are reducing the process size or the process, and then we're seeing higher memory bandwidth. So I don't think that's really much of an issue at all. So.
Yeah, I mean, that's true, right? Because it's not like we're not at hitting 4,000 and
exactly,
up and almost
yeah.
5,000 with exactly. smaller and smaller process. So.
And almost, you know, easily with some of the 4,000 memory, you know, it's you don't have to do too much configuration, and especially with like XMP or DOCP and stuff. So.
And it just started pretty, I guess DDR4 started pretty low too. I mean, it was like 2133 when it first launched and now we're at fairly high clocks.
Exactly. I think our Dominator Platinum RGB, we have 4,800 megahertz right now as our top of the line stuff. So.
Well, so as a regular person, should I care more for higher clock speeds or for lower latency?
For the regular person, I think...
It doesn't matter for either.
Well, yeah, I think, you know, honestly, you know, you have the people who are just constantly running benchmarks and they want to see those results, but I think in real world, like, what does that actually feel like? It's a little bit harder to quantify. I'd say go with what you can afford, honestly, you know, the best balance between that. Personally, I run 3200 megahertz RAM, so the timings, obviously, you can do some configuration, maybe try to tighten them up a little bit, but stability, I think, is really the name of the game right now. So.
And then I guess because when you are playing with timing or clocks on memory, you're going to have to deal with, it's just like overclocking, right? Mm-hmm. You're going to have to get your system stable at your tightest timings, and some people are not willing to do that.
Exactly. I mean, because I want to say that it's not an exact science, although there is an exact science to how it works because of all the clock cycles and everything. But it's just, I think, a lot more work than some people want to put in. You know, most of the time when you build a computer, you just want to put the RAM in and get to gaming or something. You know, so for just the typical person, myself included, I just want to jump into Overwatch or, you know, play on the new Goose game that everyone's raving about.
So, if, I mean, for the average person, then just basically going with your XMP profile.
Yes, yeah, and that's really the easiest way, honestly. If you do want to start delving further into it, they're obviously all the BIOS, they have different settings that you can go through, set all the different timings and everything, and you can actually go above the rated speed here just at your own risk.
Yeah, the overclocking disclaimer. Don't you find like most consumers probably just end up, they go out and they buy the fancy RGB memory and then they probably never actually even turn on XMP then.
Yeah.
They're running it at stock speeds.
Yeah, 2133 I've seen a lot, or 2666, whatever platform they're on, which, you know, it's kind of upsetting because they're paying, you know, if they're like, oh, I'm buying 3200 megahertz RAM, they don't necessarily understand that they have to sometimes manually implement it. Some motherboards have an auto setting where it'll automatically implement that XMP profile, but, you know, I think it comes down to education, and that we're really trying to do that through our content and stuff now, so.
Actually, speaking of education, I'm asking this specifically because I'm too old and I can't remember anything more. Is there an easy mnemonic to remember all of the memory subtimings? I mean,
it's Google it. Google it.
It's called Google it.
Yeah, that's the mnemonic.
I just wish there was an easy way to remember what.
I haven't heard
command
of any.
Rate, Tira, yeah, just yeah. It's called, the mnemonic is called use XMP, I think.
Something, yeah, yeah, just enable XMP. It's weird, different way of saying Google it, but, you know.
It's just really hard to, I guess, for an average person to, even a average gamer or an average enthusiast to really justify the time to really tighten those timings up, I guess.
Yeah, and I mean, beyond just the time sink it is to get your system running stably, I think, for most people, when they are making these changes, they kind of want to know why they're making those changes too. So then you have to like dig through all this information, and then sometimes, you know, as you're reading, your eyes just start to glass over, and you just don't particularly care about clock cycles, and you're like, you know, I'm done with this. I just want to play.
Yeah, yeah, no, I hear you, because it makes my brain hurt every time I have to try to remember what exactly all the settings are.
Yeah.
Actually, that comes to some other education I want to get over, which is, help me understand dual rank versus single rank, because it's not really marketed generally with a lot of memory and it can impact performance.
So usually like dual rank means there's two banks of memory ICs, single rank there's a single. You can see a single rank on SODIMM where there's two banks, or like there's banks on either side of the chip or the card, I guess.
Yeah.
But that's still considered a single rank, but that's because of the form factor and everything. So. Essentially, I'd say a lot of the RAM now is probably dual rank. You know, maybe some lower capacity ones are single rank. But
oh, really? So most, because I know Ryzen performance in the beginning, especially, mm-hmm. was somewhat impacted by dual rank versus single rank, mm-hmm. and I guess most like these are dual rank then probably.
Yeah. So higher capacity ones. Oh, okay. Well, this is a 32 gig kit, so. Let's see, that's, what, 8 gigs per stick. Yeah, I mean, actually, I actually don't know if these are single or dual rank.
That's why sometimes it's never ever sort of spelled out sometimes in the...
Yeah, I mean, we can just rip the heat spreaders off.
But it is important. Should I shop for dual rank, or is it just kind of like, again, one of those 2% improvements in performance?
It's going to be a nominal improvement over everyday use. I don't think it'll be perceptible. Honestly, again, if you're running heavy benchmarks and wanting to see, like, trying to break each record each time, then that's where you'll see that real difference. But under normal use for the typical gamer or workstation user, it's not going to be really noticeable. So.
Okay. And then, of course, all of your gaming RGB memory is unregistered, no ECC. Mm-hmm. Is it worth it to have ECC at all, or...? I guess you'd have to have a Xeon or a Thermal.
Right, yes. So if you want reliability, like if you need, or not want, but if you need reliability, like on a workstation environment or something, like let's say you're drafting or something for a government agency, of course you want to be able to have that extra reliability in your system. So but even then, they'll be using Xeons and stuff, so.
Yeah, and I guess some of those government contracts require you to have a
exactly
ECC and mm-hmm. Xeon.
Exactly.
Obviously, DDR5 next year, maybe?
I don't know exactly when DDR5. They're still kind of fleshing out all the details. I personally haven't heard much about it. I'm supposed to be talking with one of our DRAM engineering guys more about it, or actually the head of the DRAM engineering, Jake. So we're supposed to meet in Taiwan during Computex. We didn't get around to it. But
is it gonna? What's the quick overview though? What are we gonna get? More bandwidth?
Higher speeds. More bandwidth. It's just probably going to be hopefully more than just an incremental change, but I'm not entirely sure, honestly.
Do you think we'll get a bump in density, or?
Potentially, and obviously with the Samsung 8 eyes and everything, we're looking at hopefully having like 32 gig ICs and stuff like that too.
Oh, so, wow. Yeah. So actually, sorry to rewind back to the 8 eyes, so will it get any cheaper because it's a little denser?
I think so. I think it's speculative, but I think that's the goal, is to have like cheaper memory available to the consumer. Whatever growing pains the 8i has, you know. But I know there's actually some out there right now. They're starting to filter into the market. So.
Huh. Okay. And of course, since it's hard to predict how smooth the transition will go, so.
Right.
Memory transitions are always.
Yeah, and a lot of it, I think, comes down to perception, you know, because, again, the bead eye was held way up here. You know, everyone's a little bit leery about the new process and everything. So I think it'll be fine, though. I think within a year, you should see pretty decent maturity on that die. So
no reason to worry about that.
Yeah, so. Definitely not.
Sometimes, you know, you get parts that have a mythical quality to them. So Celeron 300A from the old days. And
yeah.
So, I was going to ask about the run DDR4 head, because it feels like we had DDR4 only got 5 years out of DDR4, because it was Haswell E. Mm-hmm. To if we do see DDR5 next year, then that was like a 4 or 5 year run. So,
well, I mean, DDR4 will still probably be produced and in the market for many years after that, even if DDR5 is on the market, just like we've seen DDR3 still being produced. In some areas, and it's still available too. So I don't think it'll just completely go away. So it's going to be one of those top-down things, you know, like the premium stuff they'll have the DDR5 in their systems. But I don't think DDR4 is going anywhere for a while.
Last question, and this is a tough one too, is because I've gone through many memory transitions. Mm-hmm. Why is it always so difficult? Because people get really, DDR4 was hard, DDR3 was hard, DDR2 was hard. Every single one of them people just get aggro about. And
I don't know. It might just be perception. Maybe people get comfortable with it. It could be due to technical specifications. If I knew more about the DDR5 spec right now, I could maybe give a little more insight on that one and see how the transition would go for there. But it could just boil down to perception, you know, people not wanting to.
People don't like change.
Yeah, exactly. Like it's that inertia, you know. So.
Okay. Well, thank you. Yeah. Check back PC World channel and also PCWorld.com for more of this cool content from Corsair headquarters.